Picture this. The CSL Whitefish Bay, as she approaches Montreal, signals the traditional maritime greeting of two long and one short blasts of the horn before slowly sliding in to the Saint-Lambert dock right across from downtown Montreal on the east bank of the St. Lawrence River. The Whitefish Bay is a bulk cargo ship that spends her life traveling around the St. Lawrence and the North American Great Lakes. Today, she's bringing a load of iron ore from Northern Labrador to a smelter in Cleveland before going west to Thunder Bay to pick up a load of Canadian prairie grain to bring back east to be sold to make bread in markets in Asia and in Europe. Deckhands from the Whitefish feed lines up to workers on the lock, and after giant doors close behind her and thousands of gallons of water come rushing into the lock, the ship and all of her cargo of ore is lifted 15 feet into the air before it can continue its route west around the island of Montreal. This lock is but one of seven on this section of the Seaway alone, one of the most important inland transportation routes on Earth, and one of the most important infrastructure projects in Canadian history. The Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway is a navigable waterway of locks, canals, dredged channels, and open lakes and rivers that run some 3,700 kilometers or 2,300 miles from Anticosti Island at the mouth of the St. Lawrence at the Atlantic Ocean all the way to the westernmost ports of Thunder Bay, Ontario and Duluth, Minnesota on Lake Superior. The Seaway gives ocean-going vessels direct access to a number of cities on the Canadian and American interior that straddle the shores of the Great Lakes. This includes cities like Montreal, Toronto, Hamilton, Sarnia, Sault Ste. Marie, and Thunder Bay in Canada, and cities in eight U.S. states, including Duluth, Milwaukee, Chicago, Gary, Detroit, Cleveland, Erie, and Buffalo. The majority of cargo that moves through the Great Lakes is iron ore, coal, and other mining products, followed very closely by agricultural goods like the grain produced in the Canadian prairies and American Midwest. Then there are some other bulk cargoes like salt and some finished goods like steel. Some 44 million tons of goods move through the Seaway every single year, and that's compared to the 11 million tons that moved through the Seaway when it first opened in the late 1950s. The St. Lawrence Seaway was predated by a series of other smaller canals. Transportation in British North America followed the indigenous tradition and used the natural highways that already existed, the lakes and the rivers, to get around. However, passengers headed to northern ports like Fort William would normally take the train out of Union Station in Toronto north to the Georgian Bay, somewhere like Owen Sound or Parry Sound, before connecting onto a steam liner to bring them further north into the lakes. There was no ship that could connect the upper Great Lakes of Superior, Michigan, Huron, and Erie to Lake Ontario, the St. Lawrence River, or the Atlantic Ocean because of one insurmountable obstacle that was on the Niagara River flowing from Lake Erie into Ontario, the powerful Niagara Falls. Between 1824 and 1829, the very first version of the Welland Canal was built to connect Lake Erie to Lake Ontario, bypassing the infamous Niagara Falls. However, that canal was only built 9 feet deep, or about 2.7 meters, which was deep enough for some of the steamship traffic at the time. By 1871, some of the locks on the St. Lawrence were large enough to allow ships that were up to 9 feet below the waterline to pass, and so the smallest lock of the Welland Canal was expanded to match. This allowed some ships to travel all the way from the Atlantic to the Great Lakes west of Niagara. The very first proposals for a comprehensive bi-national navigable waterway system on the St. Lawrence were put forward in the late 1890s. And over the next decades, developers included hydroelectric projects as an integral part of the Seaway construction project. The US proposed expanding the Seaway to Canada multiple times leading up to the First World War, but there was little response from our side of the border. By 1920, the International Joint Commission, which was created just 15 years earlier to cooperatively manage the water resources of the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence, decided to approve the project and submit some plans for study. In 1932, then Prime Minister William Lyon Mackenzie King signed a treaty of intent with a U.S. representative, even though there was still a lot of opposition to the project in Quebec. The treaty went to the U.S. Senate in November 1932. But it stayed there in debate and in committee until a final vote was finally taken on March 14, 1934. The majority of the Senate voted in favor of the treaty, but it failed to get the 2/3 that it needed to ratify the document and actually put the treaty into force.
Two new governments in Ontario and in Quebec put the conversation on hold until 1938, when the president of the Great Lakes Harbors Association argued to President Roosevelt that opening a maritime link between the Great Lakes and the Atlantic Ocean would be an economic miracle for the interior region, because ocean-going ships would be able to carry grain and other commodities directly to ports in Europe, which was already becoming an important and critical part of the United States economy. By 1940, another significant agreement had been reached between Canada and the United States, and both countries agreed to share the responsibilities and the costs of building both the hydropower and the navigation infrastructure like the locks. However, this agreement never passed U.S. Congress. See, there was a lot of resistance from lobbyists representing the interests of the Atlantic ports and the railways, because until then they had a monopoly on offloading ships on the coast and transporting goods by rail into cities like Chicago. After a 1945 attempt to convince the U.S. Congress to approve the Seaway by introducing tolls failed, the Ontario government started to become more and more desperate for a new source of power generation. After a failed 1945 attempt to convince the U.S. Congress to support the project, the Ontario government started to get a little desperate for power, as they had intended to use the hydroelectric projects on the Seaway to complement the systems they already had. Some in Canada thought that we should just go in on the project alone, and this idea started to stir an idea of pride and nationalism in the mind of Canadians around the project and around the St. Lawrence River. So, in September 1951, Canadian Prime Minister Louis Saint-Laurent informed President Truman that Canada was not willing to wait for the U.S. any longer, and that we were going to go in and build the Seaway alone. Canada authorized the founding of the St. Lawrence Seaway Authority on December 21st, 1951, and started the construction on the Ontario and Quebec portions of the Seaway, including the Moses Saunders Power Dam, which would straddle the border between Ontario and New York. The dam would significantly raise the level of the St. Lawrence River to allow ships to pass, and would generate electricity for both sides. The International Joint Commission approved the project in October 1952, and sent a bill to the U.S. Senate to approve in January of 1953. Building the Moses Saunders Power Dam was going to flood a significant part of the river's edge in both Ontario and New York State, not to mention 1,200 acres of the reserve territory and 15,000 acres of the traditional territory of the Mohawks of Akwesasne. Although the Mohawks of Akwesasne were never notified of the impending flood, the non-Indigenous farmers and village people were, and 6,500 people from six villages and three hamlets that are collectively known as the Lost Villages were relocated. Residents on the New York side of the river were also going to get flooded out, and that's what finally forced the hand of the U.S. government to make a decision on the Seaway. In May 1954, President Dwight D. Eisenhower finally signed the Wiley-Dondero Act, which approved the construction of the dam, the channels and locks in the New York portion of the Seaway, and created the St. Lawrence Seaway Development Corporation to act as the authority for the project in the United States. The need for cheap transportation for iron ore from northern Labrador and Quebec to the smelters in Cleveland, Toledo, Detroit, and Chicago is widely considered to be the reason why the pendulum finally swung in the direction of the Seaway. The Seaway officially opens in June of 1959 at a total cost of $470 million, $340 million of which was paid for by the Canadian government. Queen Elizabeth II, the Queen of Canada, and President Eisenhower formally opened the Seaway with a short cruise on the royal yacht HMY Britannia after addressing crowds in Saint-Lambert, Quebec. Over 22,000 workers were employed on the project to open this 3,700-kilometer-long superhighway to ocean traffic. The Queen herself would tour the entire Seaway, going down through the Welland Canal, visiting the city of Chicago on July 6th, and ending her tour in the westernmost Canadian ports of Port Arthur and Fort William on July 9th, 1959. The section of the mouth of the river at the Atlantic to the Port of Montreal is governed by Transport Canada out of the Port of Quebec. There isn't much of an elevation change between the Atlantic coast and Montreal, so ships can generally sail right into the St. Lawrence without hindrance. The Seaway itself has three main sections: the St. Lawrence section, the Welland Canal, and the Great Lakes area. Traveling east to west, a ship first encounters the Seaway system after traveling 810 kilometers upriver. This is where we met the CSL Whitefish Bay at the start of the video. After being raised the 15 feet in the Saint-Ambert dock, the ship continues the way around the west side of Montreal into the Côte-Sainte-Catherine channel and locks to be raised another 30 meters. This is where we met the CSL Whitefish Bay at the start of the video. The first lock at Saint-Ambert lifts the ship 15 feet, or 4.1 meters, before it's able to continue west around downtown Montreal, under the Champlain Bridge, and into the Côte-Sainte-Catherine lock, which will lift the ship another 30 feet and bring it safely by the Lachine Rapids and past the Mohawk community of Ganawage. After passing Montreal, the Whitefish Bay will continue into the two locks of the Beauharnois Canal, which cuts Salaberry de Valleyfield off from mainland Quebec. These are the last two locks in the Quebec portion of the Seaway. She'll continue towards Cornwall, sail south of Aquasasnia, and enter New York State, where she'll find the first of the two American locks at Messina, New York. First, the Snell Lock will lift the ship 45 feet, or 14 meters, into the Wiley-Dondero Canal. And then on the other side, the Eisenhower Lock raises the ship another 38 feet, or 11.6 meters, into Lake St. Lawrence. The lake was formed by the construction of the American locks, the hydroelectric dam, and the subsequent flooding. This means that the Whitefish Bay will sail over the lost villages of eastern Ontario before finally meeting the last lock of this system at Iroquois, Ontario. The Iroquois Dam will lift the ship an impressive 1 foot before it can sail out into Lake Ontario. Lake Ontario sits at 243 feet in elevation, which means that the canal systems have lifted the ship 200 feet above the sea level since it first started in Montreal. However, the most impressive challenge is yet to come, crossing the Niagara Peninsula and getting up from Lake Ontario into Lake Erie. Erie sits at 568 feet above sea level, which means that it's another 320 feet higher in elevation than Lake Ontario. And the river that connects the two, the Niagara, is impassable due to the falls. The Welland Canal cuts the peninsula in half, allowing ships to pass from Ontario into Erie. The first lock at Port Weller allows ships to enter, and then it's immediately followed by locks number 2 and 3 in St. Catharines, where you can find the information center and museum. Then, there are another 4 locks in the city of Thorold, number 4, 5, 6, and 7. Before ships can pass the majority of the canal and past the city of Welland itself. Last, the ships enter one final lock at Port Colborne on the Lake Erie coast before being able to pass safely onto the rest of the Great Lakes. The smallest lock on the Welland Canal is exactly 766 feet long, 80 feet wide, and 30 feet deep, which means that the absolute largest ship that is able to pass is exactly 740 feet long, 78 feet wide, and 26.5 feet deep. This only really gives the ship about 10 feet of clearance on the front and the back, and only 1 foot of clearance on either side of the ship in the lock. Many of the ships designed for use on the Great Lakes are built to be exactly that size, including our CSL Whitefish Bay. And the class of ship is known as Seaway Max, because it's the maximum size that can fit in the Seaway. Some ships in the Great Lakes are larger than this size, but they're built south of the Welland Canal and they'll spend their entire lives traveling Superior, Huron, Michigan, and Erie without ever going further downstream. In the case of our CSL Whitefish Bay, her first trip bringing iron ore from Labrador to Cleveland is almost complete. After unloading the ore, her crew is going to spend the next couple days cleaning the cargo holds. They'll clean every inch of the cargo holds with high-pressure power washers and cleaning products, and then leave the hatches open as they travel empty through Erie, Huron, and into Lake Superior towards Thunder Bay. The Great Lakes portion of the river is far more navigable, with open rivers and low elevation changes between Lake Erie, Huron, and Michigan. There are dredged channels that bring ships through the Detroit River, Lake St. Clair, and the St. Clair River past Windsor, Detroit, and Sarnia before entering Lake Huron. From here, ships heading south towards the American ports of Milwaukee and Chicago will keep south of the Manitoulin Islands, through the Straits of Mackinac, and under the Mackinac Bridge, before sailing on to Lake Michigan. Ships that are headed for Lake Superior pass into Munuskong Lake, and follow dredged channels around Nebish Island, passing to the east if they're heading north into Lake Superior like our Whitefish Bay, or to the west of the island if they're heading back south. Lake Nicolet is a series of dredged channels through the St. Mary's River that allows ships to approach the Sioux Locks, named after the twin cities of Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario, and Sault Ste. Marie, Michigan, sometimes just known as Sault, Michigan. The Sioux Locks were first opened way back in 1855 as a way to connect Lake Superior to the rest of the Great Lakes system. On average, 10,000 ships pass through the Sioux Locks from its April to December season. The locks close for 3 months from January to March, when the majority of the ports on Lake Superior are totally frozen over. In the Second World War, the Sioux Locks and the St. Mary's River was heavily guarded by both Canadian and American forces, because it was thought both possible and likely that the Germans would launch a one-way air attack on the locks from Norway. Here, the largest ships on the Great Lakes are able to pass. All of the commercial traffic on the Great Lakes use one of the American locks. There is, however, one on the Canadian side, but it's only really used for recreational boats. From the international bridge that connects Sault Ste. Marie, Ontario to Michigan, you can see the system of five locks that connects Lake Huron to Lake Superior. After clearing through the locks at Sault Ste. Marie, our CSL Whitefish Bay enters her namesake and starts the direct 16-hour crossing of Lake Superior into Thunder Bay to pick up the load of grain before turning around and coming back east again. There are different ships on the Great Lakes system. All of the Canadian-owned ships are the Seaway Max size, because they do have to travel on the Welland Canal between the major cities of Montreal, Toronto, and Hamilton into the inland ports like Sault Ste. Marie and Thunder Bay. However, American ships have the ability of spending their entire lives south of the canal, only bringing goods between major American ports like Cleveland, Chicago, Milwaukee, and Duluth. And this is why all 13 of the largest 1,000-foot ships on Lake Superior are American. Those two categories of ships, the Seaway Max and the 1,000-footers, are both called Lakers because they'll spend most of their life traveling around the Great Lakes. Ocean-going vessels that enter the Great Lakes are called Salties. But all Salties that enter the upper Great Lakes have to be smaller than the Seaway Max size to be able to get through the Welland Canal. Lakers are known for their very long shape, and usually have both a wheelhouse and a crew house on both ends of the ship, with the wheelhouse usually being at the front. The most famous Laker and the most recent major vessel to sink in the Great Lakes is the Edmund Fitzgerald, which sank in 1975 after an unforgiving storm in Whitefish Bay on Lake Superior snapped the ship in half like a toothpick. The Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway has brought an incredible economic opportunity for cities on the Canadian and American interior. Transportation on the Great Lakes produces $3.4 billion annually and pays out over $4.3 billion in personal income to over 150,000 people in both Canada and the United States. The Canadian Laker fleet is aging. The majority of them were built in the 50s and 60s specifically to be used on the Seaway. These need to be replaced, but lake shipbuilding has all but stopped in Canada, and the federal government currently has a 25% tariff on any ships that are built outside of the country. Not to mention that countless dockhands and shipmates feel that the Chinese steel-built ships are not as strong as their Canadian steel counterparts. The latest Lakers, called the Trillium class, which the CSL Whitefish Bay is one, were delivered to Canada Steamship Lines from Jiangyin, China in 2013, and have been sailing on the Great Lakes ever since. Cities on the Great Lakes argue that they can only do so much with the bulk cargo that they're actually able to move, and that the next step for the Seaway would be to expand the Welland Canal to allow for container ships to pass in from the Atlantic Ocean. However, the international shipping traffic on the Seaway presents an enormous environmental challenge for the important ecosystems of the Great Lakes. Not to mention that the Great Lakes provides drinking water for over 100 million people in both Canada and the United States. Activists and Indigenous water protectors argue that the majority of these freighters burn bunker fuel, and a whole lot of it. Bunker fuel can contain up to 45,000 parts per million of sulfur, which compared to car gasoline that's only allowed to have 80 parts per million, bunker fuel is extremely dirty. They argue that burning this fuel so close to the shoreline and to villages and cities is extremely dangerous. However, the industry would be quick to remind you that each ship that passes through the Sioux Locks has enough cargo to take 225 rail cars off the rails or 870 trucks off the road. that would otherwise have to pass through the city of Sault Ste. Marie to get where it's going. This is why in 2003, the St. Lawrence Seaway Management Corporation in Canada and the St. Lawrence Seaway Development Corporation in the United States partnered together to brand the Seaway as Highway H2O, to convince new customers to check out the opportunities of the Seaway and to engage with some of the cities and economies that flank its banks. One thing that we can all agree on is no matter how you look at it, the St. Lawrence Seaway has had a profound impact on the growth in the economies of Canada and the United States. It's through complicated and limit-pushing projects like this that we have come together to build one of the most dynamic economic and national partnerships on Earth. Together, we took our border, we built a highway. Thank you guys for watching this Canada Explained video. We really do hope you enjoyed it. Please leave us a like, comment what you might want to see in the future, maybe check out one of our old videos, or give us a subscribe.